I yield myself into your very capable hands. None of me and all of you, God. Holy Spirit, you have the liberty to move up and down every aisle, in and out of every row, touch, heal, deliver, set free, speak to, whisper. Father, we are open to hear your voice. We're open to hear your word. This is not Wednesday as usual. We are sitting up under the rhema word of God, the living word of God, the word that sets men free. And Father, we thank you for it. Father, we thank you for the children ministry and the youth ministry. We declare they are anointed, appointed, and approved to teach those young ones. And Father, we speak over the babies right now. We speak over the youth right now. We speak over Journey Kids right now. And we declare that the incorruptible seed will carry them all the days of their lives. Oh, I hear that, Lord. Father, I thank you right now for supernatural healing in the children's ministry, in Tender Feet, in the baby's room, in Journey Kids, in youth. I declare in the name of Jesus, the power of God will invade cells, organs, and tissues, and muscles, and bones, and breathing, and respiratory. Father, I thank you right now that supernatural healing will take place with our babies, our children, and our youth. We give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. And it's in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Oh, let's give God some praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to find you two or three people. Love on them, encourage them, let them know they're special to God and they're special to us. Glory to God. Bible, slip your hands up. Ushers can bring you one. We want you guys to follow along with us every time you come in this building. Make sure you have your Bible or your iPhone or your iPad or your Android or whatever. Just make sure you can see the word for yourself. Amen. We've been talking about the inner workings of humility, and it is, I don't know about you, but it's turning me inside out. You know, the inner workings of humility has quieted my rebuttals and responses. It's like I don't feel like I got to prove nothing to nobody. Pride feels like it's got to prove something to everybody. It's got to defend itself all the time to make sure people don't think this or think that. Jesus said, look, if you want to walk in this this tremendous humility, make yourself of no reputation. Just be known as a servant. Just make yourself known. And don't defend yourself. Let the word of God and God, you know, he says, vengeance is mine. Amen? So the inner workings of humility. Before we get going tonight, I want you to write these things down. Number one, where am I prideful at? Where am I prideful at? I can tell you right now, I can show you my first one. I've been prideful in my parenting. When my kids were little, I was prideful. In other words, my kids would never do that. If those parents would have did a better job, that wouldn't happen to that teenager, da 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 da. And you sit back and you don't realize you need to locate that pride and deal with it. And allow the word of God, when we talk about humility, to deal with that. So where am I prideful at? Am I prideful in my marriage? Am I prideful in my marriage? A prideful spouse, let me give you an example. A prideful spouse will interrogate you about $20 and justify themselves when they spend 20. But if you spend 20, they'll interrogate you. If they do it, they'll justify it. That's prideful. So am I a prideful spouse? So prideful, yeah, I was prideful in my parenting. God, messing up the anointing, man. No, I'm just kidding. Boy, if you ain't ready 24/7, you just ain't ready. Can't nobody mess up knowing all that. Shucks. What was I saying? Huh? Prideful in your marriage. Yeah. Are you prideful in your marriage? In other words, is your argument 1 hour long? And then when you're confronted, hurry up and get done with me. Sit here and listen to me now. You need to hear what I'm saying now because God is trying to show me and I'm trying to help you. Da, da, da. And you'll go for 45 minutes. But when they say, can I speak to you about something? Man, hurry up. What do you got to say? That's prideful. That's prideful. Let me get back up here to my notes. Number three, just bear with me here. Am I prideful in church? I remember when I first got born again, went to World Changers. It was 10 things they could have did different when I went in there for the first time. And I'm saying to myself, this man is 27 years old, 26 or 27, 10,000 members, built a doggone $18 million dome debt-free. And now here I am sitting in there saying, oh, now they could do this different. Man, sit down somewhere. Are you prideful in church? There's been times when I just realized, hey, you don't know the answers. You don't know what happened over here. What happened over here? Here's what you need to do. Just pray. But prideful people can convince others. I have pinpoint in church. I have pinpoint accuracy on what happened and spread it. That's pride. That's pride. Are you prideful in church? Are you prideful on your job? Are you prideful on your job? I remember talking with a guy one time. He said, I'm just going to break out and do my own thing. This guy don't know what he's doing. I'm just going to break out and do my own thing. I said, he doesn't know what he's doing. He's providing 100 people a paycheck, you included, and 100 families a paycheck every week, every month. He doesn't know what he's doing. And you're just going to break. Man, let me tell you something. That's prideful. There's weight that comes with that. And a sober-minded, humble person understands that. Man, he doesn't know what he's doing. Well, I think he does. Maybe you don't like the way he's doing what he's doing, but the evidence is there. So are you prideful on your job? Are you prideful in your prayer? Somebody said, how can I be prideful in my prayer? Every time you go to God, you want something. You want something. It's never God show me me. It's never Lord help me through tomorrow. It's never Lord help me see it the way you see it in this marriage. Help me see it the way my parents see it. Help me see it the way my super. It's never that. I need to do this and I need to do that and I need the door open so I can go ahead and exit this thing. And it's like, man, that is so prideful. God can grow us up in the thing we don't even dislike. If you're not prideful in prayer, he'll tell you, go back and stay in there. Fix it. Lift. My spiritual father would always tell me, he says, said this. And as a leader, he didn't side with you too much. What he would say was, lift your spiritual attitude. I expect that from them. I don't expect that from you. Next one. Are you a prideful leader? A prideful leader feels he has all the answers. I got an entire series I'm going to do. It's called The Lie of Leadership. The Lie of Leadership convinces people and stresses people out, and it tells the leader, you must have all the answers. You're going to stress yourself out. No leader has all the answers. That's a lie. But are you a prideful leader, supervisor, manager, team lead, minister, elder, deacon, pastor, whatever? Are you a prideful leader? Hallelujah. Glory to God. I wrote this one down because I had to really humble myself in this area. Oh, you're a prideful neighbor. God told me to be more careful. God forbid that neighbor come across that thing and hit your lawn with his little push mower and don't know what he's doing. He's got it down on 1 inch and just, my God, you're going to mess up my yard. You're going to da 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 and just get a sour taste in your mouth towards your neighbors because they did a zigzag line where the property divides itself. Sometimes we got some prideful neighbors. It's like you can't even have company for them coming over. Hey, can you park this? Can you do this? Hey, you're too far down. And it's like, hey, man, I pay taxes on these roads just like you do. That's your property. That's your lot. But this road, I can have 25 people on this road if I want to. Now, that's prideful. That's how you should think. But now it's like, you know what? I remember I had something, a guy, you know, no. My neighbor had something, and I walked out there, and I'm just looking. I said, my God, the guy don't know how to park. He got his back wheel on my edged lawn, just resting on it. I said, man, he's. And some said, just go over there and knock on. I said, I'm not going to really knock on the door. And 15 guys I don't know look at me. And when I walk off, it's going to bother me all night because I'm going to be thinking, man, they call you a clown. Who was that clown? Who was your neighbor? So I've humbled myself, you know, as a neighbor. So if my neighbor's out of town, we'll text one another, and they'll get my trash, I'll get theirs or whatever it is, and roll it up to the garage or whatever. But that's humility. But some people are real prideful with their property. Man alive, don't be a prideful neighbor. The inner workings of humility. Now, those questions are for you to answer. The inner workings of humility. I want to break this open for you and show it. Matthew 26. Matthew 26. Matthew 26, verse 53. Now, we're going to be in Matthew 26 and 27 a lot, but this right here is really Peter in his fleshly way trying to protect Jesus. In other words, he draws his sword. The soldiers are coming. They're there. He draws his sword and cut the man's ear off. And Jesus said to this Peter, this disciple that's around him, in proximity to him, let's go 26:52. Then Jesus said unto Peter, put up again your sword. In other words, put up your way of handling this kind of situation. Put up again thy sword into his place, for all they that take the sword, all people who act in fleshly pride, take the sword, shall perish by that sword. You operate in pride, you're going to perish by that pride. Verse 53, watch this now. Do you not think that I cannot now pray? This is the greatest act of humility I feel in the Bible. Do you not think that I cannot pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? What was Jesus trying to get Peter to see? I have all power in my hands. And I am humble under the will of God for my life. I have employed humility to carry out the will of God for my life. And nothing is going to take me out of that. This scripture should solve your offense. This scripture should take away all of your excuses. Well, I just kind of hauled off and grabbed her. I just kind of hauled off and hit him. I just kind of hauled off and, no. Jesus, look, I got all power to call down. Just ask my Father, deal with this. Yet I chose humility. Yet I chose humility. What is that? The inner workings of humility is in Jesus. What is he trying to just get us to see? I'm glad you asked. I'm glad you asked. What is he trying to get us to see? Jesus wants us to learn the art of walking in God's harnessed power. Harnessed. Why? Jesus harnessed himself. He could have jumped right in pride and said, you know what? I'll tell you what. I'm going to make that sword turn on you and poke you 55 times. He could have done that. He could have done that. He could have just said, drop dead, native right there. He could have just called his father, hey, deal with this. He didn't do it. Why? Because when you're a believer, if the will of God for your life doesn't have enough weight to stay out of offense and pride, you need to pull back and check yourself. Why? Because the will of God in my life is precious to me. And I can't afford to be into this with that one, afford to be employing my flesh to handle things, afford to go rebuttal for rebuttal with false accusation. I can't afford that. Why? I treasure the will of God in my life. And what Jesus was doing, right? He said, look, I got a mission to finish, and I'm not going to mess it up right here. And these guys, nor you, Peter, are going to draw me into the flesh and not cause me to abort what my Father has called me to do. So if you're going to allow the inner workings of humility to employ itself, to populate your spirit, man, you're going to have to learn the art of harnessing God's power. We say, man, I walk in God's power. I'm anointed. I speak to the mountain and all that kind of stuff. Well, guess what? You don't have to fight any battles then. Why don't you have to? There's power in staying out of the flesh and staying on course with the will of God. That's what we're seeing here. There's absolute power in staying out of the flesh and staying on course with the will of God. Now, if you think you're gonna hop into a leadership role or an influence role, and somebody say something to you, and you've got just like the Sherlock Holmes movie, when he's standing there looking at the guy, and like in his head he's already got six moves. He's already figured out, I'm going to hit you in the uppercut and chop you in the throat, and then I'm going to jump out the window. I'm already ahead of you. And I remember asking my spiritual father, I said, what's the one thing that God really delivered you from? He said, a sharp tongue. He's like a cut somebody up, upside down, list their weaknesses out in front of them, let them know where they're in error, and they would even know what hit them. He said, but the Lord delivered me from it. That's what I'm talking about. See, pride convinces us to defend. And it shouldn't. I have in my notes, pride produces immature reactions that will taint the call of God on your life in others' eyes. You ever been in a situation where you're in a meeting or you're in a big meeting and somebody does something crazy or whatever it is, you sit back and you say to yourself, okay, let me see how he handles this. Never forget, we was in pastoral training school. A couple was late. Remember? A couple was late. I think they were going to Alabama somewhere. They were going to be over to church. But they were late. The training had started. The Simulcast Church training. And man, they walked in 25 minutes late and everybody looked at them. And my pastor was standing at the podium, and he looked at him when they came. He said, are you guys okay? You made it here safe. Praise God. Let's continue. We're on page 9. Let's keep rolling. And I was like, now, wait a minute. I thought you said this is the Green Beret. People that you have in here are going to be running churches. They can't be late to preach. They can't be late to open up the church. They can't. That's what I was thinking to myself. But I was watching. So we get out to the garage, and a friend of mine was standing there, and he said, boy, I just knew you was going to just tear them up from the head to the toe. I knew you was going to let them have it just so you can teach the whole class, be on time. He said, I did teach the class. I said, huh? He said, I did do a training right there. You didn't see it? He said, no, I didn't see it. I taught leaders how to treat leaders and give them the benefit of the doubt. That's what I taught them how to do. I don't need you running something and you cursing everybody out when they're 2 minutes late. What is that? When you walk in humility, it prevents premature and immature reactions to cause people to look at you and go, wait a minute now. Are you of God or are you not? Why? Because people say stuff to you in public and people just sit around and wait on you and just see what you're going to do. I had a guy one Sunday, I went out here walking, I just walking, kind of standing around. The guy was walking around and I knew something was wrong when he was 5'8" and he had on a size 52 suit. And I said, you don't have the right suit on. It's something is up. You're 140 with a size 52 suit on. And I was saying to myself, okay, now something's up here. Can I say something to you real quick? Can I speak to you real quick? And I said, go ahead. He said, who reads the King James Bible anymore? My God, I can't believe this church is even reading the King James Bible. I said, XL Church, myself, I read the King James Bible. I said, you don't like that? He said, no, I'm an NIV guy, da, 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 da. I said, praise God, man. Look, I said, the scriptures are alive. God can anoint you, man, this, and you're welcome here at any time. Because I knew four or five guys was watching me. But it was right at the tip of my throat. To give an immature, fleshly response and not remember Matthew 26:53 now. Don't respond in the flesh and taint yourself in the eyes of the believers. That's what Jesus, that's what he's trying to teach us right here. And you got to get a hold of that. Why? This just does not apply in church. It applies at home. Watch how you say that to your wife now. Watch how you respond to your husband now. Why? Because you have little ones. You have little ones watching you, and you got to be careful. If you're gonna walk in tremendous humility, you got to watch these immature responses and reactions that pride will bring out of you. Do you hear what I'm saying? So Jesus is trying to show us that, and there's no such thing as I was just so mad I couldn't hold it in. You just acted out of pride. Why? I've been so mad, and the Holy Spirit said, don't say that. Whoa. And I'll stop, and I'll cool down. And I said, nah, she needs to know this. If I don't say something, she's not going to know it. And the Holy Spirit go, whoa. I dealt with it. She's in the back room. I dealt with it. Don't say nothing. She's back in now. Whoa. And boy, I sit there, and pride just go, look. You need to make it clear. And as soon as I open my mouth, hey, now what up? There you go again. I can't even get it out. And what is it? The Holy Spirit had dealt with it. But pride wanted me to just, and not just respond out of season, out of timing, respond out of season, out of timing in front of my kids. And Jesus is saying to Peter, look, man, I'm good. No one's going to pull me into the flesh. Matter of fact, here you go. Man, go ahead and lock me up, get me out of here. Why? I'm on track. I'm on course with the will of God for my life, and I'm imploring humility to protect that, and I'm going to follow through with God. The inner workings of humility will not allow me to make immature, premature, fleshly responses and get me out of the will of God for my life. It ain't going to happen. So I came here to tell you tonight, if you're offended at church, if you're offended at somebody, if you're offended at your husband, if you're offended at your friend, if you're offended at somebody, 9 times out of 10, you're just responding out of pride. And Jesus is trying to teach us right here, don't do that. Stay on course with God. Stay on course with him. How do I do that? I implore humility. And I remember something higher than this conversation. Something higher that what happened in this interaction that we didn't quite understand one another. So nobody has clarity, but you got to respond to the will of God, the higher thing, and it'll deal with this thing right here. Somebody say glory to God. Okay, let's now we're going to go back to Matthew. We're going to stay in Matthew 26, but we're going to go back to 50. Man, we're going back to 50? Yep. And we're going to learn some lessons from this. Matthew 26:50. And Jesus said unto him, friend, what come from? Then came they and laid hands on him, on Jesus, and took him. Man, I mean, just think all this. Just think. And we're going to see in the Word of God the tremendous restraint that humility kept on Jesus in the midst of some horrible situations. And behold, one of them, which were with Jesus, stretched out his hand and drew his sword. We just read it. Struck a servant of the high priest, cut his ear off. Then Jesus said unto him, put away your sword. That very thing is going to be your downfall if you don't put it away. Symbolic of pride. You respond out of pride, Peter. You think you're protecting me from something. I'm headed to the cross. Get out of the way. Do you not think that I can pray to my Father and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then shall the scriptures be fulfilled that thus it must be? Listen, you see what he just said, right? Stay on course for the will of God for your life. How do you think this is going to be fulfilled with you stopping it, getting in the way, or with me obeying God? Verse 55. And in the same hour, Jesus said unto the multitudes, Are you come out as against a thief with swords? Watch this now. And staves to take me? I sat daily with you, teaching in the temple, and you laid no hold on me. First lesson of the inner workings of humility out of Matthew 26. First lesson. Internal, unknown resentment. Internal in your house, in your organization, in your church, in your group, in your team. Internal, unknown resentment. It's resentment on the inside. It's more dangerous than a known enemy. Jesus said, didn't I sit with you guys teaching you in the... You're in on this too? Didn't I sit? I mean, come on. And man, I'm telling you, if your child goes against the grain on you, on the inside, it's unknown that they're working stuff in the background, in the booth, in your house. It's internal. It's unknown. That's more dangerous than somebody just flat out telling you, I want to kill you. At least I know now. At least I can protect myself. At least I carry friends with me. I got them in the house. I got them in the car. I got them on the hip. I got them on the ankle. At least now I got friends with me. I got the Holy Ghost. I got them all. But Jesus is like, man alive. This is humility. He's trying to teach us something. When you come across that, don't respond foolishly. Because he didn't. Glory to God. So we taught in the temple, verse 56, but all of this was done that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled. Watch him. See him go higher. See him go back to the will of God. See him go back to it. See, you think offense is meant to bring you down. You think unknown resentment is meant to take you off the course of the will of God. No. It's to take you higher. Well, how do I go higher? Implore humility. Choose the will of God for your life. And bless your enemy. Choose the will of God for your life and refuse to listen to gossip. Choose the will of God for your life and refuse to allow anybody to rattle your spiritual man and cause you to act out of flesh. You make your mind up tonight. The inner workings of humility are very powerful, and my Savior has shown me the man who had all the power knew how to harness himself to stay on track with God. Are you telling me I don't have any opinions? Hey, I have opinions, but I can tell when I have opinions and when I'm, it's something else happening while I'm talking. It's something else happening after I talk to you. And what is that? Well, I said something wrong there. I took something too far there. I said something deep right there. I went too far. What is that? That's pride. That's the humility alarm clock going off. Say, you need to go clean that up. I've discovered it's mainly believers, when they just say what they want to say and you come back and say what you want to say. Yeah, I just, God told me one time, you know, I mean, 10 years ago, we were suits every Sunday. Minister John, we were suits every Sunday. You know what I'm saying? Wednesday night, we suits, and like, man alive, what's going on? And I'll never forget, I was, you know, just going to the restroom, and this little guy, he's just, I mean, he was in the church, and this, and I'm using the restroom, and number one, why are you even talking to me while I'm using the restroom? But he comes up to, he said, I think you guys in black suits and red ties look stupid walking around here. And I had another guy with me, and that thing that came to my head, I started saying, and I think I can eat a two-piece chicken box off the top of your head if you just stand right there. And but I didn't say it, but here's the thing. I didn't say anything to him, but when you strike out and walk up to a believer and go, why did you put your hair that color? And she goes, why don't you put some lipstick on? You're supposed to implore the Holy Spirit. Yes, she is, but you should have never started nothing. We always want to correct the one who rebuttals, and both of you are wrong, but the bottom line is, as a believer, you just can't walk through life just saying what you want to say, especially in church. And we're shocked when people come back and say, whoa, well, wait a minute now. I never did like the way you dress either. Think of that. Short haircuts are real hard to maintain and manage. I don't know why you got that. I don't know why your lace front is not even done right. It's not even done right. So, and I've been wanting to tell you that it's not even done right. And now, here comes the email. Correct them, correct that. And it's like, no. Both of you are wrong, but you were out of line too now. Let me get back in the spirit here. Stay on my notes here. I just don't know why believers think they can just say anything to anybody. You're stunned when somebody's not quite as saved as you. I don't gamble with that. I just don't gamble with that in church. I just don't. Might be fulfilled, verse 56. Then all the disciples, watch this now, forsook him and fled. Think about this now. They've captured Jesus. His posse has fled on him. He has unknown internal resentment against him, and he still hadn't said anything to his father to call down those 12 legions of angels. He still ain't said nothing. So internal unknown resentment, and the closest people to you now have left you. You still ain't calling down Jesus? You still not going to do nothing about it? Nope. The will of God is higher. I must keep going in humility. And they that lay hold on him, the soldiers, led him away to Caiaphas, and the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. So now, he's going from one thing to the next. But Peter followed out him afar off unto the high priest's palace, went in and sat with the servants to see the end. Now the chief priest, watch this now, and the elders and all of the council sought false witnesses against Jesus. To do what? To put him to death. The inner workings of humility wants to teach us, stop defending what you know is not true. And go to the Father with what you know is true, they're saying. So you thought it was a part, you didn't think it was a part two, did you? Stop defending what you know is not true. And if 5% of what they said is true, go to the Father about that and deal with that thing now. Why? Now all of a sudden, my buddies have left me in close proximity. My whole team was against me while I was in there teaching them how to live. And now, here comes the false witnesses. But found none. Yeah, through many false witnesses came, though many false witnesses came, yet they found none. And the last came two false witnesses and said, this fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days. The guy's like, this guy right here, Jesus said, he's able, watch this now, to destroy the temple of God and build it in 3 days. And the high priest arose. You know how it is when you got a little kid. You say, get away from that. Stop now. Get away from that now. And you sitting back. And when you go, the high priest arose. He's in charge. When he heard that, what do you say now? Now you got my attention. The high priest arose and said unto him, answereth you nothing? In other words, isn't pride going to cause you to defend yourself? Wow. You're not saying nothing? You're going to allow them to do this? And let me tell you something. The high priest has the power. And he's trying to say, okay now, you need to say something. But the inner workings of humility was that they was at work in Jesus. I feel no need to defend anything. I know my God. I know the will of God for my life. I know why I'm here and what I'm doing. You don't answer nothing? What is it? Which of these witnesses against thee? Verse 63. But Jesus, watch this. The inner workings of humility teaches us, hold your peace in the midst of people trying to provoke your flesh. People trying to take you out of the will of God. I've heard people tell people, look, I'm lying. Yes, I did do it. And I know that you're going to forgive me when I come back. God, have mercy. But Jesus held his peace. The inner workings of humility teaches us. Learn this if you're in the midst of a divorce. Learn this if your spouse ran off and left you and she's telling her family or he's telling his family. This all kind. Learn to let peace rule. Let the inner workings of humility take place. Because why? You got to learn to hold your peace. If you don't learn that, you're going to jump in pride and start trying to defend yourself. He held his peace. And the high priest said unto him, I adjure thee by the living God that you tell us whether you be the Christ, the Son of God. See, this guy actually thinking he's in charge. And I'm reading this saying to myself, now, do you remember what the guy said back there in 53 now? He could say something right now and you'll drop dead. Jesus knew right then and there, I'm actually in charge. But I also understand this man right here in this arena, he's in charge, but he also thinks he's in charge of me in front of all these people. But guess what he did? He implored humility. Jesus said unto him, you have said, nevertheless, I say unto you, hereafter, shall you see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven? Verse 65, then the high priest rent his clothes. He just can't take no more. Tore them off. Rent his clothes, saying, he has spoken blasphemy. What further need do we have of these witnesses? Behold, now you have heard his blasphemy. Watch this. Remember, Matthew 26, 53, they spit in his face. Now, what would you do? Okay, now I done told you back in 53, I can call down some stuff. Now, y'all don't lie on me. You don't falsely accuse me. You don't abandon me. And now you're taking it to another level. Now you spit in my face. Better pay attention to the inner workings of humility. Now you just humiliated me. Well, let's see what he does. Let's see if the inner workings of humility is taking place or not. Watch this. He rent his clothes saying, you've spoken blasphemy. What further need we of witnesses? Behold, now you've heard blasphemy. What do you think? The answer said to him, guilty of death. Then he spit in his face and buffeted him. Spit in his face and beat him. When I was coming up, a lot of guys had a lot of mouth, but just no, they ain't have no shoulder game. They could talk a lot of stuff, but you just can't fight. you really can't fight. You're really not tough. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, if you only knew who you was talking to, you're spitting on me, I'm in chains. You beat me and I'm in chains. And I got this power, but yet the inner workings of humility causing me to restrain myself. Don't you ever get offended at church and go off and leave God for 6 months because somebody got something confused, or you didn't get a phone call back, or you didn't get an email back, or you didn't get the right kind of thing. Jesus is showing us right here, you hadn't been humiliated. Are you kidding me? Go get it right. I was spat on when I was in cuffs. I was beat when I was in cuffs. All of my family, all of my friends left me. You trying to tell me that you're proud to take you clean out of the will of God?
Yes.
So they bothered me. Others smote him with the palms of their hands. I mean, just walking up to him, smacking him, just lighting him up. And I'm saying to myself, boy, if these cuffs ever come off of me, I got killer whale memory, buddy. I'm coming for all you. That would have been me. Thank God it wasn't me. Shucks. Saying, watch this. Watch pride provoke. Try to provoke flesh. Prophesy unto us. Oh, Christ, prophesy to us. What is he that smote thee? Man, come on, man. You're really playing with my nerves. Now Peter sat without in the palace, and a little girl came over to him, a little damsel, saying, aren't you with this guy Jesus? But he denied before them all, saying, I know not what you're saying. So the very guy said, I'm going to build my church on his back, just denied me. I have no friends. I have no one. Everyone's falsely accusing me. There's going to be some people that's not going to even pay attention to what I'm saying, who I was and what I did it for. But yet and still, I'm going to humble myself to death so that they may live. I'm going to do it. You're not going to pull me out. Guess what? Pontius Pilate don't know me. These disciples don't know me. I mean, who cares? Jesus is like, look, man, I'm the only one standing in proxy for you right now. These guys left me. They don't care anything about you. It's your Lord and Savior that's going to be there for you. And everybody's gone. And he's trying to teach us, remain humble now. Let the inner workings of humility take place now. Don't start trying to pick apart what you learned when you was inside. See these people, you know, yeah, I was at a company and up Google, and it's like, man, it's 200 of them coming out of the works now. Yeah, and we kind of massaged a little data there and da 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 da, and now it's, man, we didn't massage no data. That was a glitch. But because you can get on Entertainment Tonight, they draw you in and you betray me. That's what's happening right here. Are you with me? So Peter flat out denies the guys. A little girl comes and says, hey, aren't you with him? And when he was going out into the porch, another maid saw him. Now watch this now. Another maid saw Peter and said unto them that was there, this fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth. And again, watch this, he denied. Watch this, with an oath. I swear I don't know this man. Why is this story so important? Because it's showing you Jesus is at his lowest of low. And he's still walking in humility. I want to show you in Matthew 26:53, that at any time, I can solve this now. At any time, I can stop the spitting in the face. At any time, I can stop all the slapping. I can stop all the hitting. I can stop all the insults. I can stop all the gossip. I can stop all the false. I can stop it at any time. I told you that. But incident after incident where prideful people will be responding in the flesh, I'm showing you how to respond in humility. Yes, yes. This will be a stress-free life for you if you just stop trying to defend. You know, it's like I seen a movie one time. It was and this person just started a rumor. It just got out of control. They was offended, started a rumor. And the guy said, I'm going to go back and fix it. He said, you can't. He says, like you going on the top of that building right there, cutting a pillowcase open. and it's 100-mile winds blowing, and all the feathers go everywhere. Man, there's some in cars, there's some in motors, there's some in the sewer, there's some up in trees. People pick some up and drove cross-country with it. They're everywhere. They're in the trash. People put them in the landfill. They're everywhere. You can't go back and get that. But thank God that we serve a Lord that when we are forgiven, we are forgiven. And here's the thing. Humility tries to protect you from doing stuff like that. But pride will make you keep going. I'm so scared of pride because something come right after that thing. Somebody said, "You afraid of that? Be not deceived." God, like, this ain't funny. You do live by law, seed time, harvest time. I don't want to do that. No way. And if you've done it, go ahead and clean it up. So it out of him. After a while came unto him saying, that stood by and said, surely you're one of them. Why? Man, you sound just like Maurice Chandler. You're from New York. I hear it in your voice. You got a New York accent. Nope. I'm not from New York. No, I'm straight out of Alabama. Man, what in the world? Man, he is going to all lengths to distance himself from a Savior who fought for him. Now, from the 6 hours there was darkness. Wait a minute. Hold on. Wait a minute. Oop, there we go. Right? Yeah. After that, okay, my Bible is not misread. Okay, there we go. Then began he to curse and to swear. You know how it is. Man, man, stop it. You're just lying. Lying doesn't further convince anybody. You know how you get caught in something, and your husband go, and you just go crazy. Or your kids just go, "You don't want to listen to me. No one cares about me." And what you got to do is say, "I've been in sessions like this. Oh gosh, she got on my nerve." And I just sit there. You done? Because all this outburst is not gonna keep me from asking you again. Did you or did you not do it? But see, Peter's think he can exaggerate his way out of this. Can't do it, brother. He told you he was going to deny him. That's what's happening. Glory to God. And Peter remembered the words of Jesus. Somebody say that. And Peter remembered the words of Jesus. Guess what Jesus didn't do? He did not taint his witness in front of Peter. He did not hop in the flesh and cause Peter to go, "Wait a minute, now you taught us to, you always." He did not do it. And Peter remembered the words of Jesus, which said unto him, "Before the cock crows, you'll deny me 3 times. And he went out and wept bitterly. And you know, humility always wins. Humility and employing it, it always wins. Because in the case of Peter, humility, he didn't go out crying. He didn't go out cursing Jesus out. He didn't go out spreading more rumors. He went off to himself and he thought, "That's a man of God." See, humility causes people. No. Let me say this. Humility, when you act in humility, you don't partner with the enemy to cloud their judgment, to make a godly decision. When you get in pride and you start arguing, you start getting in rebuttal with him, you start going back at him, it's cloudy now. Now I'm fighting you. I'm not fighting the discomfort that's in here. It's fighting you now. So guess what? Now you're in the way. But Peter went and wept. That tells me when you're in any kind of situation, any kind of denial, any kind of false accusations, any any turmoil, anything, choose humility. Why? When you choose humility, it's going to open their ears to the Holy Spirit. Yeah. And people start saying, "He's never done nothing to me. What am I even doing? He's never, she's never, they never done. What is that? Humility opens that door. But if you're pride for pride, it never gets open. Why? You're fighting in the flesh. Both of you are fighting in the flesh. Let's keep rocking and rolling here. Are you getting anything out of this? Glory to God. Hallelujah. John 9. Let's go to John 10 real quick. John 10 real quick. The inner workings of humility. I remember my first time hearing about a marriage conference, you know, and Pastor Creflo Dollar talking about, I want to speak to the men Wednesday and all this kind of stuff. And I mean, Saturday morning, and you know, I want to help you be a husband, a man of God in your house and lead your household. I remember hearing that just with carnal ears and saying to myself, okay, now what are you gonna teach me? Not knowing, 1 year around the corner, you're gonna come across some marital hell because of how you're carrying yourself, both spiritually and in that house as a husband, that you're gonna need what I have to say. And I was just sitting there in pride, like, man, I don't know if I need that. Because see, pride doesn't like to be told what to do. It's just something about they just don't want to be told what to do. And I said, man, I don't know if I'm going to that thing or not. Shucks. I mean, I don't know if I need 5 years of marriage. Year five. Year six. I'm in IHOP with my pastors and my wife saying, this is over. How do we get here? Because pride will allow you to operate on assumption. Wow. Not realizing you don't have nothing there. All you have in this thing is a woman who's submitting her life to God as a wife to you. But the day she says, you know what, God, if this is what you're going to deliver, let me time out real quick and go over here by myself and take care of myself. Now, people hear that and go, well, what, she disconnect from God? No, she didn't disconnect from God. But my God, is this what God is delivering? You sit up under the words, you do this, you do that, and you still? No. But pride won't let you hear that. And I came here to tell you tonight, if Jesus was a prideful man, we wouldn't be here today. You know what he told the will of God? It's not going to happen. I'm telling you right now, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen, and I got the power too, and I'm ready to do some stuff. I'm ready to do some stuff. Think about Satan. God, you're not going to stop him? Man, you're just going to let him. Good gracious. We wouldn't be here today if we had a prideful Savior. Our Savior taught us how to be humble. Our Savior told us if you want to be high, you go low. Our Savior told us you want power, humble yourself. John 10. This is important for our reading here. The inner workings of humility. I don't want to read all that. Right here, Jesus is trying to get them to see, like if you come John 10, you come up to 15, he's trying to get them to see that listen to John 15, as the Father knoweth me, even so I the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold. So they may have 45 tattoos, and you don't even realize, Jesus is like, I know they don't look like what you used to in church, but I got other sheep you just don't know about. Don't judge. Don't do that. No, they don't dress. No, they ain't got dressed to the ankles. You know what I'm saying? They wear jeans. They like makeup. But some Christians look at you, you're not holy enough. And he's like, I got sheep you don't even know about. They don't look like you, but they're mine. That's not the context of the story, but that's for you to know. you know, when religious people get around, you say, well, they don't look like, well, Jesus said, look, he got sheep that we don't even know about. Be careful how you judge people. Now, this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall be one fold and one shepherd. Therefore, does my Father love me because, watch this, I lay down my life that I might take it again. No man can take my life. So he's well versed on the power that he walks in. Can't no man take my life. The only way that happens is I lay it down. And that's what I did in Matthew 26. I laid it down. No man can take it. How much humility do you have to have to walk this earth for 3.5 years like that? No man can take it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down. I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received from my Father. Hold on now. Wait a minute now. Now, Matthew 26, we didn't hear that. What you just said was, I can lay it down, and I can take it up. And guess who told me that? So I could have showed out. And I didn't do it. What is the lesson in that? What is the lesson in that? I have 3 minutes. Humility has self-control. Humility has self-control. In the midst of the lesser accusing you. They take it to the HR director, and you're over 100 people, and you got the lesser in there. An employee down on floor 8 accusing you. You go in there, well, I feel like, you know, discrimination taking place, da 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 da. And now, speaking from a believer's perspective, you get in there with a power hungry person, when you come out of that meeting, pack your bags. Because that power hungry, prideful person is coming after you. But here's what he's saying. You go into HR, and Jesus is there, and the accusations are happening. It's like, man, I never did that. I never said that. And I never, no, he's a great employee. She's a great employee. I mean, I don't want to lose him off my team. I don't want to do that. What is that? He knows. Right here in the midst, I have the power to go ahead and say one word. You're out of here. They're going to believe me over you anyway. But guess what? Humility has self-control. In the midst, when you're in the midst of the lesser, humility has self-control. Your kids. This is heavy stuff. You know, when stuff is heavy, you got to take baby steps. You ever been moving something, and you should go low, but you go high, and you grab the dresser, and you what are you doing? This thing is, I can't do this. Why? It's heavy. But if you get up under it, it gets light. That's how humility is. Pride. When there's heavy things happening in your life, like what's happening to Jesus, sometimes you just got to grab that thing and just inch it forward in humility. But you're going to grab it, and you're going to have to take baby steps with it. But when you lower yourself, you get over that thing so quick. Why? You get it out of the way so quick. Why? Your strength has increased. You've added legs, back. Right here, you're just fingertips. Pride wants to keep you right here. Offense want to keep you right here. And some people struggle to bring $20 out of their pocket to the Lord and Savior and honor him in the midst of God's blessing showing up in their life. They struggle. What are they doing? They're there. Humble yourself. Use your legs. Use your back. Humble yourself and realize you wouldn't have that if it wasn't for Jesus working through you and men who gave it to you. Glory to God. Amen. Let's keep going. So humility has self-control. Jesus demonstrates to us the art of following God's will and not allowing people, offenses, or institutions to derail him. Remember, they took him amongst the elders. Institutions, false accusations. See, when you're walking in this humility I'm talking about, you can't be derailed. Why? God fights all of your battles. I know who I am. But you can be the queen of gossip in church. Insecure is all outdoors. And you don't know how to take the word of God and deal with your situation, so you try to employ other folks in with you. Instead of just choosing humility, amen? John 19, real quick, and we'll pick up here next week. Boop, do you remember our like first class of Summit One? Do you remember that? No, my first. You weren't there because you came later. So we're doing that, and I'm back and forth from Atlanta. Get in the car on Friday, drive down, stay with my pastor. Wake up, go to ministerial school, 8 o'clock in the morning, 2 hours, clean up in church, go to church Sunday morning, get out of first service, go to second service, get out of second service, and go back to Atlanta. I did that for, 9 months? Almost a year. And I can remember in the midst of that, a teaching was going forth. I said, I think I'm gonna stay on down here for this one and kind of finish it out. And he was teaching on the transfer of the anointing. And I was like, boy, this is really good. This is wow, this is awesome. Man, a live transfer of the anointing. And he made a statement. And the statement was, I don't need what's on your life. I said, man, what was that? And he said, my marriage is blessed. My pockets are loaded. I ain't in no sin. I ain't in none of that kind of stuff. I'm living my life for God. I was just sitting there like, wow. Man, man, boy, is that a prideful step? Man, that's kind of, and I can remember the Holy Spirit saying to me, is his feet beautiful or not? If they're not, don't make another trip down here. Stay in Atlanta. I said, my God, what? What was that? That thing caused me to examine my marriage, my money, and everything. I said, shoot, I ain't never heard it like that. I need to pay attention to what this man is saying about marriage and about this. And the Holy Spirit snatched me out of pride. Sometimes people are so deep in the pride, the Holy Spirit can't even tell them, turn around. Stop. He's right. Remember my wife told me when we first became vegans, she said, you read the back of the thing? I said, yeah. Holy Spirit said, you lied. You don't want to read the back and see 5% milk. You want to taste this thing and you want to do it now. She, the Holy Spirit said, you're lying. I said, I ain't lying. I don't even know if I even seen what she's talking about. And it's like, no, humble yourself now. Derek, did you read it? Humble yourself now. And humility, the Holy Spirit says, go read it. It's got 5% dairy in it. Guess we go ahead and pour it out and just get rid of it. And I can remember when we first became vegan, pride would say, look, it's not all that serious. Now, I need you to know you're stressing me out with this food thing. It's stressing you out. Am I your partner in it or not? And pride says, no. You're going too far with it now. No. No dairy. No meat. Period. No seafood. Period. Not 1%. Not 2. But pride was like, this is going too far. I finally humbled myself and said this right here. Either you are or you're not. But there's no in between. There's no lukewarmness in this. And pride would keep you lukewarm. Either you are a forgiver of people or you're not. And I'm trying to help you now. Either you are generous towards God or you're not. Stop telling yourself that you are and you're not. It's pride that's telling you that. You want to convince yourself that you're that. Don't allow it to do it. Just don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. We'll pick up next week. Let's stand to our feet here. Let's stand to our feet and give God some praise. Let's stand to our feet and give God some praise. Father, we just thank you right now. We praise your name. We hallow your name, Lord. Father, we declare we are humble people before you. Lord, we implore humility into our lives, in our relationships, in our businesses, in our money, on our jobs. God, we just thank you that the inner workings of humility has taken root in us. Our families, our generations will be stronger in their walk with you. Father, we hallow your name. We praise your name. Father, we bind the know-it-all spirit. We don't want to know it all. You can't know it all. We are not omnipotent. You are God. We humble ourselves to your wisdom. We humble ourselves to your revelation. Father, we need revelation. We need lightning to strike. And you show us. Show us the one thing, God. Show us the one thing to take our marriage further. Not about them, about us. Show us the one thing, God, that can heal us. What do we need to remove? What do we need to add? Lord, we receive it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. Spouses. It's for somebody. You're not God. You hit a line when your husband is into something bad news or whatever it is, you're not God. You're a comforter. That's all you are. My wife gets a phone call, I get a phone call, or whatever, with our family, whatever. If I weep with my family, you know what she's doing? She's weeping. And 4 days later, she's got to eye on me like this. Why? Check me for the temperature. If I'm getting stronger, you stay strong. Don't rehash it because you're emotional. Somebody need to hear that. Be strong for your spouse. Be compassionate for your spouse in the midst of the job layoff. If he begins to trend towards a smile, don't come back 4 days and you're freaking out. I need to go up there and let her know that she can't talk to my husband that way. Stop that. The Holy Spirit has already dealt with him. He's stronger. And here you come, trying to be mini God. Stop. Never forget, my pastor would say, hey, let me tell you something. He would tell the family, hey, when this home going starts, you look at the mama. If the mama's sitting on that front row and she ain't trying to jump and get in no casket, she ain't falling all over the place, don't you guys do that now. Why? She's the temperature on how you should be responding. Since I've been preaching on enlargement and pride, I'm here to tell you, he'll throw everything he has at you to distract you over here, and you don't need to get distracted. You need to stay strong in the Word of God. We're always going to have situations and circumstances. It's going to watch this now. Not take our faith, test it. You have to pass the test. Why? Because if if God forbid her and her sister's going at it, and here I am, ain't nobody gonna talk to my wife like that. And the Holy Spirit has dealt with my wife. She's back on fire, back in good relations with her sister. And here I come, trying to be a mini God. Shut your mouth. Watch her. She's okay. You're okay. I don't even know who that's for. But I came to tell you, the devil, he's a master at watching one get victory. He said, now how can I remind them? You don't feel what you feel. Right through a little mini, what I was calling one time, mini Messiah. Derek, leave your wife alone and let God deal with her. Amen. If you're married in this room, just hug your spouse. Just embrace them. Just hug on them. I see you on your toes, boo. Come on up here. I'm looking at Cassandra, but I see you. You know what I'm saying? I see you coming on up here. You know what I'm saying? Give big daddy. Give big daddy a hug. There you go. Oh yeah. Sticky. You gotta hear what I'm saying, because when God is elevating her, I can come in super husband, thinking I'm gonna fix it. And I'm working with the devil. Man, you're taking her right back. Sometimes you gotta get out of the way and just embrace and hug and have the ministry of there. Yeah. Here. I'm here. And I'm letting that word work in you. And every time the devil throws a job loss or a layoff at you again, guess what? He or she is stronger now. Yeah. It don't rattle them now. Now you don't go to Baskin and Robbins and eat up 5,000 calories. You're going home and boil you some broccoli. Amen. The Holy Spirit wants you to hear that. The Holy Spirit wants you to hear that. Why? We excel in God. We excel in life. And sometimes I can get so spiritual that I just get flat out in the way. Why? I want to take the credit. God's like, that's private. You ain't taking nothing. This one is mine. What do you want me to do? Just be there. That's it. Yeah, just be there. And watch her temperature. Derek, can we just pray about this? Yeah, let's go. Let's pray. Now, you sure we don't need to call? It's like, Holy Spirit's like, get out the way, man. Get out the way. Love your wife. Love your husband. Love your children. Love your neighbor, man. And God himself loves you. You can't even quantify the love God has for you. Amen. Father God, you've been in this place tonight. The Holy Spirit has moved. If God is telling you right now to get to this altar, don't let shame hold you down. Don't let guilt hold you down. Don't let pride tell you it's okay. Humility is trying to populate you, to raise you higher, to place you in power.